the best education possible. She grew vegetables, kept chicken, took in washing and sent the son to the university with a graduate on the graduation day. The son invited the mother to receive the degree. But she said, a typical cook, I cannot go, I have nothing to wear. But the son insisted and finally took her to the ceremony in her plain cotton dress. Son tried to take her to sit with his classmates' wealthy parents. But on this point, she went and sat at the extreme left where she could still get a view. The son delivered his message and was handed his piece of paper, that is his degree and the medal. And with the sound of the exploding applause, he went straight over to his mother and put the medal on her, saying, Mother, this belongs to you. You earned it. This mother had not achieved alone. Her faith in Jesus Christ and values she taught was her daily strength. Prayer of a mother can change the children's life. Absolutely. Of course, sometimes the child has to undergo an ugly phase. Like a sculptorist made the statue out of a stone. Constant chiseling and hammering gave the shape to the ugly stone to a beautiful statue. Same with the faith in Jesus, we mothers can give the best of the virtues to our children.
Good morning. I've already got my invitation time is up. And I think it means me has been warning me. Bura padoge? Lamba padoge? Bura bolna hai? I'll try to be as short as I can. And as we all have already spoken a lot about the characters, about the mothers in the Bible, if I chose to speak about some mothers through whom I got a lot to learn while I was preparing this message. And usually as we grow older and we mature in our life, we begin to realize more and more how many sacrifices our own mother made for us. Even when as we were children and even now, when we ourselves are married, we still have our mothers sacrificing a lot for us. So I have chosen three mothers from the Bible. The first is Eve, the mother of us all. And we very happily attribute all of our sufferings to the big disobedience that she made in the Garden of Eden. So whatever we suffer today, it's all because of Eve, the consequences of her sin. But maybe we could be a little kinder to her and just think about what kind of life she led. After the fall, she had no mother. She was just all by herself. And she just had Adam to give her companionship. She also was the first mother who saw her own sons commit homicide. She was the first mother to bury her child. And how about a mother who has no one to help her go through that pain of burying your own child, seeing your child dead in front of your eyes, with no one to lean on? She had just one person to lean on, and that was God. And then, even the pain and suffering that the curse brought upon all of us of childbirth, I think there's a lot we can learn from that as well. Before the fall, if there was no pain in childbirth, it could be like, oh, happy, I'm pregnant. 9 months, oh, very nice. Baby born, oh, very nice. The joy would be so monotonous, and would we actually understand that what is the meaning of having a child, bringing up the child, if everything was just so happy, we would be able to bring the child up as just of something just too full of joy. But because she experienced pain, and because we experience that pain, when we hold the child for the first time in our arms, it's actually something that we marvel that how could God do something so perfect with a person so imperfect as me? And that gives us the strength that, no, I cannot repeat what I did. I have to learn from that pain. And for that pain that I suffered, I'll try to make sure that my child lives up to be God's child. So in such times when we have no hope, and we have so many sisters in our church, our friends, when anything goes wrong, we immediately call it. I call it Smita, sometimes Shilpa, sometimes Susan, and I'm so upset. And you know, we all get things, send me messages, and I feel very good about it. But Eve had no one to support her. She just stood by herself. But then again, it was because of the fall, and after the fall, that all this happened. So we get to learn quite a lot from Eve, that we should lean on God alone, rather than on our understanding, seeking help from others. If we spend time with God, God actually can talk to us and tell us what to do in every suffering or every difficult situation that we are in. The next model that I chose from the Bible was Jochebed, I hope I'm pronouncing it correctly. That is the mother of Moses. She showed great trust in God's faithfulness and protection from her child. And she was willing to actually give up her child rather than seeing him killed. You know, we all aspire for so many things in our life, good marriage, financial security, good career, so many good things. But then circumstances don't really favor them and we don't get everything we need, we want or we ask for. At such times, we are just left with a lot of disappointment. But if we learn from Moses' mother, we can learn that if we just let go and trust the Lord, He might have just wonderful dreams, wonderful plans for us, which we cannot even imagine. And had Joseph ever imagined that her son would one day lead the people of, lead the Hebrews out of the slavery of Egypt? I don't think she could ever imagine. The time when she placed Moses in the basket, all she wanted was that let my child live. Let him be saved. Let someone just find him. Someone who will not get him killed. That is all she wanted. But she never would have imagined that her son would be leading such a big multitude of people to the promised land. And that I feel so, when we just let go and just leave things in God's hands, and through faith, we can just tell God, Lord, I know you are there and you can just take care of this. We'll be surprised how those beautiful dreams just unfold in front of our eyes, you know. And we say, God, you had this for me? I just wanted this, but you gave me something so great. And then the last, the third mother, I also had chosen Mary, but since Auntie Nassie has already spoken a lot about what I wanted to say, so I chose Hannah also. We all know about Hannah, her barrenness, her persistent prayer. She kept on praying and praying and praying. She prayed without stopping. Like Paul tells us, pray without ceasing. You know, when our prayers take time to get answered, we usually either stop praying or very diplomatically, like what I do, I say that, oh Lord, it doesn't seem to be your will. Okay, so let me teach you to accept whatever you have in store for me. And then I say, you see, I'm being so good. I'm willing to submit before you. But Hannah didn't do that. She kept praying and she made God open her womb, bless her with a son. So the first thing we learned from Hannah's life was pray without ceasing. And the second thing is she made a promise to God that if you bless me with a son, I will give that son to you. My son will work for you. I'll give it up to the Lord. And she kept her promise. When her child was born, she went back to the temple and handed over Samuel to Eli and said, this is my promise to the Lord. It definitely must have pained her to, you know, the son whom she had prayed for so many years and she got it at quite a late age. How long did she spend time with him? But she kept her promise. She said, I made a promise, I stand by it, and I give back my son to the Lord. She went back, she did it. Every year, once a year, she had a permission to go and meet Samuel. And you know, she took a blue robe and she stitched herself. And in that robe, I think in every stitch, she must have put such a lot of love. The only way that she could show her love to her son, that although you're away from me, but I, your mother, I am with you and I still love you and I am keeping my promise. And if I were to find that robe, it would be just so filled with love for me to wear. So another thing that we can learn from Hannah's life is keep your promise to the Lord. Sometimes when we get something that we've been praying for, we're so excited and we say, and we actually forget, okay, can we do that achievement, where at the right time she took a son and handed him over to the Lord. So I did not take much of your time, and another thing, this one small point about Mary that I wanted to mention was that at the crucifixion, you know, everybody left Jesus. The followers went away, his disciples went away, but it was Mary who stayed by him until the end. So through everything, through all difficult times, good times, bad times, it is mothers who actually stand by children. So I chose a verse from 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8. And this I would like to give as an encouragement to others, and also I would like to dedicate it to them, because this is what we actually do. It says, keep your love for one another at full strength, because love covers a multitude of sin. Now this means that love doesn't make a mockery of our sins, of our foolishness, of our immaturity, our bad decisions, but instead, love, without trying to hide the truth, puts issues to rest in the love and forgiveness of Christ. And I think that is what we mothers do every day, many times in a day, many times in a minute. So, happy Mother's Day to all of you. Thank you.